So, Varsha, now that we've seen all of this, a few sort of questions that I had, okay, and
Sure.
wanted you to give us a little bit of an thinking. See, many times, no, we see technology keeps evolving, right? So today, maybe everybody's talking about cloud. Tomorrow, everybody's talking about AI. So,
Yeah.
how do organizations figure out what skills will be needed and how many skills are available in the market? You know, so how many AI engineers or how many CI/CD engineers are available in the market? So, how does an organization get a picture like that? Because technology keeps evolving, no, things keep changing. So it's very hard to stay on top.
Sure, I think I have put up a couple of examples for us to look at. This typically happens, what you're talking about, you know, competencies moving in a not just in the tech industry, but also in other industries, say like pharma or chemical industry. So we have seen this happening in other sectors also. It becomes
Okay.
extremely critical when it comes to tech because the pace of change in tech industry, everybody knows, right? It's phenomenal. But it also happens in other sectors also. It's a little more conservative. So the traditional conservative forecast models are created by organizations taking into consideration, say, maybe about 6 to 8 factors. Okay, and some of those factors typically would be what's the availability of labor force? So how many people will be available in this particular region, in this particular country? You know, how many of them will be, say, you know, bachelors, graduates in pharma, in chemical, or you know, whichever industry we're talking about. So that would be one part of the growth. The other thing, and so the first thing that you would do is to estimate the demand. What is it that the industry will need? How many engineers will the tech industry need? The first one is, of course, how is the labor force growing? The second one is, how is the industry output itself growing? So there are certain assumptions that you would look at in terms of this industry growing over the next few years. So you would look at industry output and you would look at how the aggregate economy is growing, how the sector contribution. So how much does India IT services contribute to as GDP of the economy? GDP is gross domestic produce for India, right? What is the industry employment that is associated with that? Once you put all these into a mix, you create a model saying that this is in year 2015, 2016. These are the point forecasts saying that with this kind of an industry output, with this sector contribution to GDP, I will need this much amount of labor force. I will need this much amount of industry employment. That is called the demand side estimation. So all you have done in this one particular slide, looking at all of this, is to say that, okay, today as IT industry, we need X lakhs of technology engineers, IT engineers in this particular sector. In 2025, this is what we will need. Some of the, you know, there are some studies like Workforce for the Future, which talks about which are the skills that will be important. Okay, where is it that we see these skills growing to? And those also contribute to the demand. Right? So once you have looked at the demand, the next thing that you do is you also look at the supply, saying that, okay, you have started off with 2 lakhs of engineers. You have so many more in the pipeline. These many positions are going to be coming up. In this particular example, you can see that till 2010, there was a surplus number of you know, people available for the positions that were there. But after that, it has become talent scarce. So the gap between the supply and your demand curves, once you plot them, will tell you, saying, okay, this is where this kind of a skill, this is where this kind of a competency will become very difficult to hire for. And as an industry, as a sector, we would like to focus on this particular skill set. It could be AI, it could be machine learning, right? So these are something that would be required for tomorrow. But what might not be required is, say, skills in accounts payable, accounts receivable, because those are just posting of queries, posting of ledger entries, and that can be automated. So those are some of the assumptions that you will see behind these numbers, but it's a fairly complex process. Organizations would love to do this, but most organizations who do this are actually part of an industry association. So you would have somebody like a NASSCOM, okay? Or you would have somebody like the Indian Chambers of Commerce doing these studies, doing these simulations to figure out what is going to be the talent scarcity and where is it that they need to put in money into skill development and skill building. So I know there's a lot of big words in that, but you know, that's how it's done.
So Jeevi, this is actually a little bit of the macroeconomics piece that we looked at in the first 4 weeks.
Correct. We did it for goods. We did it for goods, but here this looks like for labor. Correct. Actually. Yeah. And for each category of labor, specialized labor. So you're looking skill-wise in some sense. What is the demand and supply? So for the HR, the people are, you can project a demand for people. Even I didn't realize that that's what I've done. I mean, this chart seems to say that actually creating a demand and supply for people.
Yes. Yes.
You're looking at the labor market, actually. Yeah.
So the Singapore government actually has done detailed studies on the labor market, and they have done extensive mapping of what competencies. So typically it's done by, as I said, governments. Okay, because they're the ones who have a macro perspective. They know what kind of people will be available. They know how the industries are growing and what they will need to promote as education. So Singapore government has done a fantastic job in creating these competencies library and figuring out where people stand as of now.
Okay.
Now, this is very interesting. You know, I always see all these news items saying India will need 1 million engineering graduates in 2025 or something like that. And now I begin to understand, you know, what is some of the work that goes in beneath those headlines. Okay. So the second sort of summarizing question, Varsha, I had, you know, I think at least as a lay person, I understand some of the challenges in getting, what a production person does, you know, how he makes gears, how he, I also understand how a logistics person works. He gets a parcel from the warehouse to my house. What really does HR do? I think today you gave us a little bit of a flavor, but I'm still curious, you know, what keeps the HR people busy? Because it's not a very intuitive thing, right? So what keeps HR people busy?
So there are quite a few challenges that are there that the HR person has to really deal with. And what I'm sharing with you on this particular slide is what have been the top priorities for an HR person in, say, 2018. Last 2 years, the CHRO has actually been much more central to an organization delivering its business, because
CHRO is Chief HR Officer, huh?
Correct. CHRO is Chief HR Officer. Chief Human HR. Resource Officer, yes.
Yeah, okay.
But before COVID happened, the CHRO had to make sure that somebody who's who's started work in 1990 is as engaged as somebody who's going to start work in 2020, right? And these two generations, if I can just even look at India, are very different. One came from an extremely scarcity mindset, and the other is somebody who is hooked onto information 24/7. So managing multi-generational workforce has been one of the biggest challenges. How do you make sure that your benefits actually talk to both, right? Flexible working before the pandemic was a big challenge for the HR folks to organize. Managers are not sure whether people are really performing to their best when it is work from home. Pandemic has
changed. I think in the last 2 years that has changed. I think, Varsha.
Not really. If you see some of the biggest challenges that people are facing today after the second wave, the HR people are saying, "How do I get people to come back to work?" Why does an HR person or why does a manager need people to come back to work? A lot of time is not, people think it's wasting time at the water cooler. It's not that. A lot of information gets exchanged at the water cooler. A lot of learning happens at the water cooler, which is currently not happening. Right? So everybody knows, and this is equally true in education, right? The efficacy of education or the efficacy of having teams work together has significantly been diluted. People don't want to come back to work, very rightly so, because they're worried about the third wave. But leaders and HR people need to make sure that while they allow for flexible working, there is also this kind of buildup of organization. We've been doing without it because we have not had a choice. Right? So how do you develop leaders for succession if you're not going to meet them? How do you get them to work with teams if they have not seen their teams? Which is one of the first challenges, developing leaders for succession, building skills across workforce, making sure you're getting top talent, where you need from a leadership perspective. So all of this requires people to make sure you can balance the flexible working. What the HR people are also currently dealing with is the rise of the free agent or the gig worker. In India, there are labor and legislation issues which may not make it that easy for gig workers, right? But today you do see business models, whether it's a Swiggy or a Zomato or a Uber. Essentially, these are all gig workers. Technically. Apart from that, you also have white collar gig workers. And how do you really work with them? What is your employment model for them? How will that work? If you have talent scarcity, how do you make sure that the gig worker is equally productive as a full-time employee? Right? Then, of course, there is talent scarcity that I've been talking about. Last but not the least is organizations in India today are not just looking at sourcing from India. It was easy culturally to look at Indians, Indian people for Indian jobs. But increasingly they have realized that there is some amount, and this happens globally, there is that learning by having people who are divorced. And you will see leaders even in some of your IT industry, in your pharma industry, leaders who have basically been parachuted from elsewhere just to make sure that the growth is kept at a certain level. You've seen that in one of the leading IT services players in India. You have a global leader. One of the leading pharma players has recently picked up a chief operating officer from Europe. All of these experiences, global sourcing, throws a challenge of cultural integration.
In automotive as well, quite a few of the senior managers are from outside India, right?
Yes. Yes.
A lot of them are from Germany, I think.
Yes. So you would have, you know, leaders coming from anywhere in the world. And that's equally true of other organizations also, if you see worldwide. You will see US MNCs with CEOs from all around the world. And so is it in Europe. So you see that happening.
Right.
So this is what keeps the HR busy, making sure people are engaged. They could be from different generations. They could be different modes of employment, making sure that people are learning. And making sure that people are performing. There's a lot of words on these slides, but this is what the HR would typically want as results. Staying,
but learning, at the labor, you and I don't realize that HR does all this, no?
Yeah, because typically HR has always been an enabling or a support function. Right, it's still the manager in a sense who is the last point of delivery for all of these experiences to the employee. It is the manager, you know, because of whom an employee stays a little longer. It is often the manager or the culture he is built because of which an employee learns a little more. Right, so you have good managers, good coaches, good counselors as managers. Right. HR just creates a ecosystem that the manager can thrive in.
Understood.